Today, I recreated Conway's Game of Life with Redstone. For those who don't know the Game of Life, let me explain, it is super interesting. The goal of the Game of Life is to prove that complex behavior can emerge from simple rules. So how does it do that? Well, first we start with an infinite grid or a very big grid of cells, which can either be alive or dead. Now, this whole grid lives a generation-based life. That's one of the reasons why it's called the Game of Life. Each generation, we're gonna apply three simple rules. So, if a cell is alive and has less than two alive neighbors, then it dies from underpopulation. However, if a cell is alive, but this time has more than three alive neighbors around it, then it dies from overcrowding. And finally, if a cell is dead and has exactly three neighbors, then it gets brought back to life. Those three rules are really straightforward, yet they are enough to create tons and tons of crazy and interesting behaviors. Let's see some of them. Alright, here I have a 7x7 grid, and yeah, let's see some cows, shall we? First, I'm gonna turn on a few cells like so. So just kind of turning them on at random. Here are the cells that turned on and off. Just so that we are on the same page, cells that are lit up are actually alive cells, and cells that are not lit up are actually dead cells. So yeah, let's start the simulation real quick. So, boop, we press that lever, flick that lever actually, and yeah, we're gonna see. Let's see the chaos. Yeah, there's a ton of things happening, and it's already... What the heck? It's already done. There's like nothing anymore. Okay, let's try turning on some random cells to make it go for a bit longer. Okay, it's doing something. Oh yeah, it's doing something. Yes, let's go. So you see, I turned on one cell and you can see that a ton of strange things are happening. Let's have a look at a rather less chaotic formation. So this formation is actually called a glider, and it's a formation able to, well, glide along the board infinitely diagonally that way. So we're gonna start the simulation real quick. Up, okay, and if I start the simulation, you guys are gonna see that it actually just glides down the entire board. Boop, boop, boop. By the way, yeah, I switched to a 15x15 board. It's not the most optimized thing in the world, but really it changed the sort of resolution so that I can show you guys better. So yeah, it just basically just glides infinitely. So I value your time. So here are some other interesting formations real quick. Formations can be really chaotic, but some stay still like this square over there, or this diamond over here. And some others are actually cyclic, meaning that they take a certain amount of generations to come back to their original state. For example, this bar right here has a cycle of 2 generations, because it takes 2 generations to come back to its original state. Look, 1, 2. 1, 2. And lastly, we're going to take a look at what chaos looks like on a 45x45 board. I filled it all with 50% of the cells being alive ones, and yeah, let's see how it unfolds. Alright, so we go, we activate, we make it past a generation. It's going to be... Oh my gosh, it's going to be terrible. For my PC at least. Oh my god, okay. Okay, we can see the next cells. Yes, okay. This generation has passed. I'm trying to simulate it as fast as I can, but it's really hard for my PC right now. TPS 500, technically, my Minecraft is running 25 times faster. Oh my god, okay, it's taking a long time. This island over there here is gonna die next generation. Goodbye, island. We got a rectangle. What would be interesting? We got a bar here. Which was one of our still lives of before, that we saw before. Another bar. That's also a still life. This next generation is not gonna move, as you can see here. This is also a still life with the square over there, this diamond shape as well. We got a ton of interesting things going on. We have a glider here. We actually have a glider. So yeah, as you can see, we got our glider here. It's gonna actually collide with this formation over there. And that's basically about it. Everything else is basically hella chaotic. That is so, so, so interesting. And you can make some much, much more complex stuff in the Game of Life. As it's Turing complete, it means that given enough memory, you could simulate your own computer in the Game of Life, or games such as Pong, or the Game of Life itself. That's crazy! That's super crazy! Lastly, for this video, I wanted to give you guys a brief glimpse of what's happening under the hood, under this huge cell grid over there. So first, each cell in the grid is the exact same and has the exact same circuit to make it work. What a cell needs in the Game of Life is a counter to keep track of how many alive and dead cells there are around it. And the second thing it needs is actually a generation signal. This signal is only going to be a redstone line, spanning the entire grid, and when it turns on, it makes the cell pass a generation and flips its state based on how many alive and dead cells there are around it. Simple in talking, not really in practice. For example, how do we count how many alive or dead neighbors there are around a cell? The first thing I realized is that you don't need to count both the number of dead neighbors and alive neighbors, because you can deduce one from the other. If I count the number of alive cells around this one, we have 0, 1, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2. So we have two alive cells. How many dead cells there are around this cell here? Well, actually 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. How do you get 6? You do the total amount of neighbors minus the number of alive cells, which is 2 in this case. So we can only keep track of one count and deduce the number of dead cells from the other. And then the second thing I realized is that you actually don't need to calculate how many dead neighbors there are around the cell, as the rules only need to know how many alive neighbors there are. Like look, we have if cell alive and alive neighbors is less than 2, alive neighbors, alive neighbors, alive neighbors. It just checks the alive neighbors. We don't care about dead neighbors. So now, how do we count how many alive neighbors there are around the cell? I use a pretty useful concept, which I call signal strength counting. It's actually pretty common. This idea is that you start with an 8, and then for each of the 8 neighbors, if it's alive, then we subtract 1 from the count using the comparator's subtract mode. Here is our main 8 signal strength barrel that our comparator is actually reading from. And you can see that at the end, the output, the number of neighbors, is also at 8 because we haven't subtracted anything yet. Now I have these 8 levers over there, which represents the state of the 8 neighbors around the cell. If I set this neighbor to alive, we can see that our signal strength out is now 7. And 7 is actually 8 minus 1, which means that we have 1 alive neighbor in the mix, and we can see that we actually have 1. And if I flick this lever on as well, if I set this neighbor to alive as well, we can see at the end that we now have 6, which is 8 minus 2, meaning that we have 2 alive neighbors around the cell. Let's get back to our cell and slap that concept in, and you got the light blue, blue, and cyan part. These parts basically takes care of the cell sending a redstone signal to the other 8 adjacent cells if it's alive, and those cells will add 1 to the alive neighbor count. Or really, subtract 1 signal strength to their internal counter, so to say. The last few parts in the cell are for the logic, such as the yellow, magenta, and orange parts that represents a Boolean expression where if it's true, the cell should switch state whenever a generation is happening. Basically, we have our generation signal down there, and when it turns on, the cell asks itself, well, is this Boolean expression over there true? And if yes, it flips its state, meaning that if it was alive, it's now dead, and if it's dead, it comes back to life. By the way, this Boolean expression has been written by my friend Matt Batwings. So yeah, thanks to him for the help, link in desk, really cool. The last few colors are for the other miscellaneous functions in the cell. For example, the red part is a reset cell signal, switching the cell off, or effectively setting its state to dead. This is only used when we want to reset the board to an empty state. Or even that white part up there, which actually takes care of turning on or off the redstone lamps so that we can actually like know visually if the cell is on or off. So yeah, now stack this boy both in the X and Z direction, hook up some control lines for the generation and reset mechanism, and yeah, you got yourself Conway's Game of Life. Anyway, I thought it was pretty cool, so I wanted to show you. See ya.